Hello everyone, welcome to MBBS classes. Myself Dr. Hanifa. Today in this video I'll be talking on the complications of chronic otitis media. Here in this video I'll be talking only on the intracranial complications. The intratemporal or the extracranial complications is already discussed in the part 1 of this video. So the intracranial complications arising due to the chronic otitis media, it could be extradural abscess, sigmoid sinus thrombosis or otherwise called as lateral sinus thrombosis, meningitis. Next is the brain abscess, which could be temporal or cerebellar in location, subdural abscess, and lastly otitic hydrocephalus. If you see in this diagram, we can see here the locations of different abscess. Let us see. So this is the dura, the abscess which is outside the dura, in between the bone, cranial bone, is the extradural abscess. The abscess which is beyond the dura, this is the location for the subdural abscess. This is brain abscess, and if you see, this is a sigmoid sinus schematic diagram along with the sigmoid sinus thrombosis. Now let us see the different complications one by one. Extradural abscess, it is the collection of pus between the cranial bones and the dura mater. The location could be in the posterior cranial fossa, middle cranial fossa, or it could be the perisinus abscess, which is the beginning point for the starting of sigmoid sinus thrombosis. So let us see into the diagram. If you see here, this is the cranial bone, this is the overlying dura, and this is the brain tissue. So here we can see there is a collection of pus between the bones and the dura mater. If you see here again, this is the sigmoid sinus. The collection of the pus between the sinus and the bone is called as the perisinus abscess, which is again a type of extradural abscess. In this diagram we can see here, this is the extradural abscess and this is a subperiosteal abscess. Sometimes, in very rare cases, the extradural abscess can present as a subperiosteal abscess through the erosion of the skull. In that case, it is called as Pott's puff tumor. So, how will we know that the patient is having extradural abscess? In most of the cases, it is discovered during the mastoidectomy. In some patients, if along with the signs and symptoms of chronic otitis media, the patient is complaining of very deep-seated earache along with fever, then we should suspect extradural abscess. Moreover, on tapping the temporal bone and the posterior fossa, there will be tenderness. So the diagnosis clinically sometimes it is not easy, but if during the examination, if there is a relief of the deep-seated pain on aspiration or on the suction cleaning of the ear discharge, it suggests the diagnosis of extradural abscess. Next complication is sigmoid sinus thrombosis, or otherwise it is also called as lateral sinus thrombosis. So in the pre-antibiotic era, this complication was very much common, but nowadays with the discovery and the use of the good antibiotics, it is not very commonly seen nowadays. But statistically, it accounts for around 20% of the intracranial complications. Sometimes the sinus sigmoid sinus thrombosis, it may occur alone, but it is seen that half of the cases of the sigmoid sinus thrombosis, they occur in association with other intracranial complications like cerebellar abscess or meningitis. So how do the sigmoid sinus thrombosis develops? The first initiating point is the erosion of the bone which is overlying the sigmoid sinus, either by the cholestatoma or the granulation tissue. If you see here, this is the sigmoid sinus, this is the bone overlying the sigmoid sinus. If there is erosion of the bone, there will be formation of the perisinus abscess. If you see here, outside the sinus wall, in between the bone, there is a formation of perisinus abscess. Because of this perisinus abscess, the pressure necrosis of the outer wall, dural wall of the sinus occurs. So the outer wall, there is, we can see here the inflammation has begun. Now when the inflammation of the sinus wall, it involves the tunica intima, that is the innermost part, then there is a collection of, or we can see there is an accumulation of the fibrin, blood cells and the platelets at the site of necrosis, which leads to the formation of thrombus. So in some of the cases, there can be only thrombosis. In some patients, this thrombus may be secondarily infected. In these cases where the infection of the thrombus occurs, then sometimes these septic emboli can be disseminated to the other parts of the body. In some of the cases, the thrombosis may be localized only in the sigmoid sinus, or it can spread either anterograde or in the retrograde manner, either to the internal jugular vein, or sometimes it can spread to involve the transverse sinus, and sometimes it may extend up to the torcula. The clinical presentation, nowadays most of the sigmoid sinus thrombosis, it remains silent because of the use of antibiotics. In a typical case of sigmoid sinus thrombosis, we get a fever which is of type of picket fence fever. So this picket fence fever, if you see here, this is a picket fence. The picket fence, if you see here, there is a steep rise and fall of the edges. So similarly, in case of sigmoid sinus thrombosis, it consists of the rise of the temperature. Sudden rise of temperature up to 39 to 40 degrees Celsius along with rigor, and there will be rapid fall of the temperature. Whenever there is a rapid fall, it will be always accompanied by the profuse sweating. Moreover, we get headache and vomiting in case of sigmoid sinus thrombosis. One sign is sometimes it may be seen in few of the patients, which is called as Griesinger sign, where we get the edema in the neighborhood of mastoid emissary veins. That is, the edema extends up to the occipital region. The reason being, if we remember from the anatomy of the temporal bone, the sigmoid sinus is connected with the mastoid emissary veins. If the sigmoid sinus thrombosis, it extends up to the internal jugular vein, in these cases, the patient may have associated neck torticollis and tenderness along the anterior part of the neck. Sometimes it may present as the sign and symptoms of cavernous sinus thrombosis, and if there is a septic emboli to the lung, they may present very rarely as lung abscess or metastatic abscess in the subcutaneous tissues and the joints. Meningitis is one of the most common intracranial complications of chronic otitis media. It is an infection of the pia mater which invades the brain. The mode of spread of the infection up to the meninges, it could be through the direct extension through the dura mater due to the thrombophlebitis, or by the erosion by the disease, that is the cholestatoma or the granulation tissue. Sometimes it could be an extension of the disease from the extradural abscess or sigmoid sinus thrombosis. In some of the cases, first the patient develops suppurative labyrinthitis, and then the infection reaches the meninges via the cochlear aqueduct. If we look into the microbiology, it is a mixed type of organisms, the most common being the Haemophilus influenza, Streptococcus, Pneumococcus, Bacillus, Proteus and Pseudomonas. These are some of the common organisms responsible for the meningitis due to the chronic otitis media. So clinically, a case of meningitis will present with a severe headache. Moreover, there will be fever, there will be stiffness of the neck, and the patient will have an altered mental status. In the later stage, they may present with photophobia and the generalized hyperesthesia. Just like the other intracranial complications, meningitis sometimes may occur in co-association with the other complications like brain abscess or sigmoid sinus thrombosis. In the later stages or in the final stages, there may be a development of paralysis, and there may be associated cranial nerve palsy. So if a patient is presenting with these symptoms, in examination, we should look for the nuchal rigidity, Koenig sign and Brusinski sign, and a neurological consultation must be taken. Brain abscess, which occur due to the chronic otitis media or of ear origin are called as otogenic brain abscess. It can be in the temporal lobe or it could be in the cerebellar area. So temporal abscess is more commoner than the cerebellar abscess. So the temporal abscess, it develops when the disease spreads directly through the erosion of the bone and it involves the temporal lobe or by the retrograde thrombophlebitis. It is seen that the cerebellar abscess formation usually occurs when there is extension of the infection from the mastoid posteriorly and medially through the Trautmann's triangle, which is the triangular area which is bounded by the superficial petrosal sinus above, labyrinth and the facial nerve interiorly, and the sigmoid sinus laterally. Sometimes the cerebellar abscess can result from the sigmoid sinus thrombophlebitis or sometimes from the labyrinthitis. The formation of the brain abscess, it takes weeks to develop. So the stages of formation they are divided into four stages. The first is the stage of invasion or the development of encephalitis. So what happens is that when the bacteria reaches the brain parenchyma via the venous channels, which are leading from the mastoid. Obviously, the mastoid is the source. So there will be migration of the polymorphs or the leukocytes into the local capillaries, and it leads to the stage of focal cerebritis. So when the patient is presenting in this stage, that is the first stage of invasion, they can be well managed with the good antibiotic coverage. Next is the stage of localization. This stage, it remains clinically silent and it takes around 2 to 3 weeks to develop. In this stage, there is a formation of capsule around the abscess. When there is a capsule formation, it attempts to halt the development and the extension of the abscess. After the stage of localization comes the stage of manifest abscess, when the abscess size, it increases. And at this stage, the patient will present clinically due to either raised intracranial tension or due to some disturbance in the functions. Last stage is the stage of termination, when the abscess ruptures into the ventricle or the subarachnoid space, leading to meningitis. The clinical presentation of brain abscess, it is dependent on the three factors. The symptoms are due to increased intracranial pressure, due to the focal disturbance of functions, and due to the systemic disturbances. The signs and symptoms of the increased intracranial pressure are headache, vomiting, drowsiness, there will be confusion, lethargy, and coma. If we get drowsiness, then it indicates that there is a possibility of tentorial herniation and the midbrain compression. The next sign and symptoms is due to the focal disturbances of the function due to its particular location. In cases of temporal lobe abscess, we may get homonymous visual field defects. There will be contralateral hemiparesis and nominal dysphagia. In cases of cerebellar abscess, there will be presence of dysdiakinesia, action tremor, dysmetria, and coarse horizontal nystagmus. Lastly, due to the systemic disturbances, the patient, they are very ill emaciated, febrile, and they look very much exhausted. The next very fulminant type of complication is the subdural abscess. The subdural abscess is the collection of the pus or the abscess in the subdural space. It is a neurosurgical emergency. Here, the pus collects between the dura mater and the pia arachnoid mater. The spread of the disease is by the direct bone spread or by the retrograde venous propagation. What it does, because there is a pus, it leads to the thrombophlebitis of the cortical veins, which results in the swelling, necrosis, and infarction of the cortex, resulting in the rapid deterioration of the condition of the patient. The signs and symptoms of the subdural abscess, it takes few hours to few days. So if we compare from the brain abscess, it is very much fast deteriorating condition. The patient will have severe headache. Just like other intracranial complications, there will be generalized malaise, there will be a rise of temperature, and there will be abrupt decline in the level of consciousness. The other symptoms may be aphasia, contralateral hemiparesis. We may get Jacksonian seizure and paralysis of the conjugate gaze. One very rare intracranial complications of chronic otitis media is the otitic hydrocephalus. It is a condition which results in the signs and symptoms of acute hydrocephalus, which results from the reduced venous drainage of the cranium. The name is a misnomer because even though it is called as hydrocephalus, there is no enlargement of the ventricular system. In a true hydrocephalus, we get enlarged ventricular system, but here in otitic hydrocephalus, the ventricle size is smaller than usual. The reason of the development of this hydrocephalus is that it occurs when the sigmoid sinus thrombosis, it extends to the torcular region. So when there is a extension to this torcular region, there will be inadequate absorption of the CSF by the arachnoid villi, resulting in the sign and symptoms of increased intracranial hypertension. So how do they present? The presentation is like intermittent diffuse severe headache, and there is a symptoms of raised intracranial tension like altered sensorium, dull sensorium, decreased visual acuity, and progression to coma and death. The symptoms of the otitic hydrocephalus, they depend on the size of the involved sinus and the adequacy of the collateral venous networks. So till now we have seen the different intracranial complications. So coming to the diagnosis part. First, in the diagnosis, the most important thing is the history. In history, we have to take into account the duration and the characteristic of ear discharge, the symptoms during the history taking which are suggestive of intracranial complications are fever, headache, altered sensorium, and vertigo. Moreover, the chronology of the symptoms, they help to differentiate between the different intracranial complications, because just remember, the brain abscess, it takes weeks to develop, whereas the meningitis and subdural abscess, they take only few hours to several days to become fulminant. So the chronology also helps to differentiate between the different types of complications. So if the patient is having a history of ear discharge suggestive of atrioventral type of CSVM, the first examination which should be done is the otoscopic and the microscopic examination. We are not going into the details of this because we have already discussed in the another video on chronic otitis media. Since the complications of chronic otitis media are most commonly found in atrioventral type, and this atrioventral type of chronic otitis media is associated with two important features, that is cholestatoma and the granulation tissue. So when we do the examination, there may be the presence of edema of the posterior superior bony canal wall, perforation or the retraction of the atric region, granulation tissue, polyps or cholestatoma, or we could also get scutum erosion. So these are the three otoscopic images. If we see one by one, let us begin from here. We can see here there is a defect in the atic region. A polypoidal mass, reddish in color, is protruding through this defect. So this is a granulation tissue which is presenting as the polyp from the atic region. In this otoscopic image, we can see the keratin flakes, whitish flakes, and this is a pocket which is a retraction pocket in the atic region. If you see here, there is a perforation here in the pars tensa also, and there is another perforation of the atic and the erosion of the scutum. So in cases of chronic otitis media with complications, there are certain general examination which should be taken into account. The temperature, it provides the pre-treatment baseline of the patient, and it helps in the follow-up of the patient during the treatment course. Next is the neurological examination. The neurologic consultation must be taken. We have to take into account the level of consciousness of the patient, the signs of meningeal irritation, and other neurological deficit. Ophthalmological consultation must always be taken to see the fundus and to rule out papilloedema, which is suggestive of increased intracranial hypertension. Investigations which must be sought for in chronic otitis media with complications. Let us begin from the blood parameters. So the patient must be advised the routine blood investigations like complete blood count with the peripheral blood smear. We have to see for the features of sepsis. The culture and sensitivity of the ear discharge must be done. If we are suspecting sigmoid sinus thrombosis, then the culture and sensitivity of the blood sample must be taken. Then in cases of suspected meningitis, after ruling out the increased intracranial tension and brain abscess, the CSF analysis must be done. When we do the CSF analysis, along with the microbiological analysis, the biochemical and the microscopic should be asked for. The radiological investigations which are needed in these cases, the first being the X-ray of the mastoid. We may get the clouding of the air cells and destruction of the bone. Contrast-enhanced CT and MRI play a vital role in cases of intracranial complications along with chronic otitis media. It helps to assess the extent of the disease and the different intracranial complications. MR venography is sometimes needed in cases of suspected venous thrombosis. So whenever we are suspecting a meningitis, a CT scan must always be done to rule out the presence of brain abscess, subdural empyema, and after ruling out the papilloedema, lumbar puncture is done and CSF analysis of the cerebrospinal fluid must be done. So the CSF finding in pyogenic meningitis, the first will be the rise in the CSF pressure. The appearance is turbid. When microscopically, there will be increase in the total leukocyte count with the predominant polymorphs. In the biochemical examination of the CSF, we will get the high protein level and low glucose level. So these findings are consistent with the pyogenic meningitis. CT scan plays a vital role in the intracranial complications. Now let us see some of the important findings we may get. In sigmoid sinus thrombosis, we get sometimes delta sign. Delta sign, or it is also called as the sign of empty triangle. Here in this case, there will be enhancement of the sinus walls, but not of the contents of the sinus. In cases of subdural abscess, in CT, there will be a crescent-shaped low-density collection of pus, which is displacing the brain away from the inner table. CT in brain abscess, the CT plays a vital role in localization and in assessing the size of the abscess. Moreover, we have to do a routine follow-up CTs to observe the progress of the abscess during the course of treatment. MRI in intracranial complications, especially in cases of brain abscess, it can help to differentiate between the pus, abscess, capsule, edema, and the normal brain tissue. And moreover, in cases of disease spreading to the ventricles and the subarachnoid space, MRI is more specific than the CT scan. Now, coming to the treatment part, in general, in cases of intracranial complications or extracranial complications with chronic otitis media, the patient must be started with broad-spectrum injectable antibiotics covering both aerobic and the anaerobic organisms. And moreover, once the culture report comes, the antibiotics are changed as per the culture and sensitivity reports. So to treat the ear disease, the different type of operations which may be done is cortical mastoidectomy, modified radical mastoidectomy, and radical mastoidectomy. Now let us see in short about the specific treatment of the individual complications. So these are the extracranial complications. In Bezold's abscess, which is a collection of the pus in the upper part of the neck below the sternocleidomastoid, it needs drainage through the separate incision in the neck. If there is a coalescent mastoiditis, the patient will need cortical mastoidectomy. In cases of facial paralysis with chronic otitis media, the exploration of the mastoid in the middle ear must be done, and the root of the facial nerve from the geniculate ganglion to the stylomastoid foramen must be explored. And if there is any granulation tissue over the facial nerve, it must be scraped off gently. In cases where the facial nerve gets severed, sometimes it needs reconstruction with another nerve. In cases of petrositis, In most of the cases, the high dose intravenous antibiotic is enough in the acute phase. And while doing mastectomy, if there is any ear cell tract which is pneumatizing and spreading the disease, those particular ear cell tract must be curated while doing mastoid exploration. Now let us come into the specific treatment of the intracranial complications. Let us begin with the extradural abscess. Extradural abscess, most of the time they are encountered or they are diagnosed at the time of surgery, that is while doing the mastectomy. So the treatment which is enough is either cortical, modified radical or radical mastectomy. Subdural abscess is a neurosurgical emergency. It needs the series of burr holes or craniotomy to drain the subdural abscess. Otogenic brain abscess, they need excision of the abscess or evacuation of the pus. It depends on the surgeon's preference along with the radical mastectomy to remove the primary ear disease. To treat the otitic hydrocephalus, first of all, the medications like diuretics and corticosteroids are used, and if to control the intracranial hypertension, sometimes the patient may need repeated lumbar puncture or sometimes lumboperitoneal shunt. Sigmoid sinus thrombosis, mastectomy is the treatment of choice along with the coverage of broad spectrum intravenous antibiotics. So when we are doing mastectomy, a healthy sigmoid sinus is appearance wise, it is soft, bluish in color, and it is compressible with a probe. But if the sinus, it feels firm, whitish and opaque, these findings, it's suggestive of thrombosis at the time of mastoid exploration. If there is an abscess inside the thrombosis, then the sinus must be open and the abscess must be removed. Sigmoid sinus thrombosis will be discussed in details in another video. With this, I come to an end of this video. Thank you for watching this video.